For Krima Media's policy, I'm Sane Dlamini. Investigative journalist for Amabungane, De Walt van Rensburg, is in conversation with policy about his book titled VBS, A Dream Defrauded. De Walt, for the benefit of our viewers who may not be familiar with the VBS case, can you briefly outline how it all started at the then Rand Afrikaans University?
Okay, so back in the middle to late 90s, there was a group of university friends, accounting students. They all stayed in the same res. Some of them were a bit before the others, but basically you had a small group of accounting students, some from Venda, some from Free State, who got to know each other. And we would go into business later, some of them. But the more important thing is that the group of them ended up controlling VBS Mutual Bank. It was very much an old boys club, small and modest as it were, not a lot of old money, but people who knew each other, from the chair through to the CEO.
So the title in itself is striking. Whose dream are you referring to in the book?
Well, it's a dream professed by the very people who defrauded it, but it is, I think, also a widely recognized dream or aspiration in this country. It's a cornerstone of the transformation project to have the very powerful financial services sector, to have a very strong black contender in that space who is not the creation of a Sanlam or a big bank that's kind of carved off a little piece in a BE deal. A true company built from the ground up. I think there was a lot of expectation on this fairly small and modest group that it could be that thing. It could be a kind of a champion of sorts. And as such, it I think represented a dream. That's the way I put it.
You're meeting now with the VBS boss, Tsifiwa Matodzi, in November 2019. It was very interesting when I read, because he was expecting to be arrested, but at the same time, he said he hadn't done anything wrong. What were his reasons?
Well, I mean, I suppose you can expect to be arrested without doing anything wrong if you think you're being framed or illegitimately prosecuted, persecuted. And he certainly put that forth as a theory that, he is a fall guy for other people who had failed, not committed fraud, but simply failed to run the bank properly. That was his kind of story, that all the missing money was not missing at all. It just appeared to be missing because of bad accounting and bad administration, which is, would be a shocking, almost supernatural kind of incompetence if it were true on behalf of bank executives. But that was his story. I mean, obviously he can't, give an interview to a journalist and says, yes, I'm completely guilty. I can't wait to get locked up, So, I mean, some version of the approach he took would have been necessary. And I'm glad he took the time to sit with me and take me through his version, because it gives you a great deal of insight into the man and how he thinks and, who he is.
And many people's dreams were shattered, if I may say, if you read about what happened. And the bank was also run like a Ponzi scheme, which eventually collapsed. How was the bank hijacked, if you can just briefly tell us, in 2015?
Well, it started a bit earlier than that. So it's an old, very old institution from the 80s. It was small, it was modest, and it was going broke, and it was going to crash. Around 2011, this man, Tsifiwa Matodzi, got wind of this. He started organizing a way to participate in a rights issue and take up shares and pay money into this bank. And one of his friends at university came along for the ride, and they found a well-known group of businessmen, David Mabilo, to also fund a part of this bid. And they ultimately took control of a quarter of the bank. They were like white knight investors. They were going to turn this thing around. That was 2013-14. By 2015, things started going the other way, which is that money started going out the back end in ways it shouldn't. People were lending themselves a lot of money. All the bosses suddenly have car loans and car you know, car loans, home loans, overdrafts. And that's really how it started. All that debt eventually got erased artificially, and that obviously takes the money away from real depositors. That dynamic just increased in such a spectacular way that ultimately it was about 2.3 billion rand that, you know, was on the books but didn't really exist.
So, Devalt, it was interesting to read that there was a plan now to create the Shembe Bank, if I may say so, which is the Nazareth Church Baptist in 2016, which could have been massive given the large support that the church enjoys. Can you tell us about that?
So, I mean, initially when these guys started out, they had plans that were incredibly ambitious. And I mean, with hindsight, you wonder maybe when they started out, they were earnest. They wanted to build a really, really ambitious, successful bank. At the same time, if the schemes had worked out, there would have been just so much more money to steal. So their plan was to hook up with the Shembe Church, hundreds of thousands of members at the very least, and strike a deal whereby the membership cards of the church are in fact bank cards from VBS. So you'd recruit every single member of the church automatically as someone with a retail account at the bank. And there'd be a profit share with the bank, with the church, of course. And I mean, it would have come at, you know, at no price. So that was the plan. That plan, never quite worked out. And VBS, frankly, VBS wasn't capable of doing it. It didn't have the ability to have that many clients suddenly out of the blue. It tried to find other clinical partners. It failed in that regard. But it also had other plans similar. It wanted to recruit taxi associations and have all their drivers bank. It wanted to recruit unions and have all their members. They even went to the municipal union, Sambu, which would have been ironic because they lost municipalities' money and they could very well have lost the municipal workers' money on top of that. So that they were really going for that all the time, these mass-based kind of things, and that never, ever worked out for them.
Can you also tell us now how KPMG audit partner Sipho Malaba was also roped into allegedly covering up the disappearance of hundreds of millions of rands?
Yeah, well, Sipho Malaba's role is crucial, and I mean, he is one of the first people to be charged and put in the dock. In fact, he's the bribe money, alleged bribe money he received is you know, a larger amount than many of the executives, because he was key. And what he did basically is to receive the accounts. It's obvious that the cash they're reporting isn't real, and he would simply pretend it was and sign off on the thing. At that point, last time he did that, it was like 700 million missing. It subsequently became a far larger number. But that was the bank crash before he had to sign off on the next set of books. So he never was put in that position. The way he came to be corrupted is I think, conflicted, because I've spoken to people who were at the bank, you know, for a long time, and they said, oh, look, he was straight arrow. Can't believe he did what he did. And also, the books up until 2016-17 weren't obviously cooked. You know, they were true representations, as far as anyone could tell what was happening. It's only at that point that the books become a complete fantasy, you know, that they're just not real at all. So he was a key cog, and he is the reason the Reserve Bank had no idea what was going on, because his audit report is what they rely on to a large extent. And he's the reason that shareholders would not have known what was going on.
Now, we can't talk about this case and not talk about our former president, Jacob Zuma, who also benefited from the VBS Bank. Can you tell us how his constant and disastrous cabinet reshuffles made this possible?
So the way... you know, there's two issues. So Zuma, obviously, everyone knows, got a big home loan from VBS, and that's really how the bank became famous. So you can speculate about his personal, consideration of the bank or interest in it. But more importantly, it was suddenly a signal to ANC people that this bank is open for business and can do things for you. And what's interesting is that the big political patron of VBS was a man called Danny Masiza, Treasurer General of the party, Limpopo. And a lot of the information we have in the bank that's reflected in the book comes from messages around his actions on behalf of the bank, including talk of him joining National Cabinet, which would have been the case in one of Jacob Zuma's many, many cabinet reshuffles, which you know, this news was shared with executives at the bank, which means like a very small, you know, kind of elite privy to these kind of things beforehand. They knew that the reshuffle was coming, for instance. That's knowledge so valuable as to be it's indescribably valuable information if you were perhaps going to try some insider trading. So that there is that. I mean, the fact that level of knowledge existed is itself quite astonishing.
And lastly, Devalt, as one of the journalists who first broke the story, what are you hoping readers ultimately take away after reading this book?
It wasn't intended as a moral lesson. It's more a history lesson. But what you have to learn is how these things actually work. I hope I also conveyed that, you know, they're not cardboard gangsters. These are real people. They come from a place, they have a history. You know, they met each other as children, basically. And then they come a long way. They come from our society. And it's important to understand how systems can be corrupted, how, you know, people who fulfill a certain function can be turned to do, you know, things. It's quite easily turned. People who, you know, friends and colleagues say, you know, they've been clean for years and years, never suspect them of anything. Suddenly, after a few million rand, will, you know, sell it all down the river and do all sorts of things. I think it's kind of a cautionary tale of how things work when you have a scandal like this, how they work on the inside.
That was Devalt van Rensburg in conversation with Polity about his book titled VBS, A Dream Defrauded.